Good afternoon. Welcome to Chapter 8, or Lesson 3, Lecture 2. Any way you want to call it, this is all about meters. And we're going to be, once again, using the principles we learn in Chapters 4, 5, 6 we're going to apply the principles here, just like I said. So as I said, this is Chapter 8, which is all about meters. So we're going to look at a couple different types of meters. We're going to look at how coil movement meters work, or moving coil meters. We're going to talk about meter shunts. We're going to talk about voltmeters and their scaling. We're going to talk about all kinds of stuff, so we may as well get going with it right now. So here's some more Chapter 8 stuff. Okay, the two types of meters we most often work with are the VOM, which is an analog meter. It's still a multimeter because it does voltage. So there's DC volts, there's AC volts. It does ohms. So there's your ohm scales. It does current. Pardon me. Let's see here. Ah, here's your ohm scale on this one. So this is your current scale. DC volts here and current down here. So current's down there. Ohms is right there. There's DC volts and there's AC volts. So you can take multiple types of measurements with it, and it uses, as I said, a coil movement meter, which means I'll show you what a coil movement's all about, but this needle is going to move, and there's various scales that you can read off. This is your ohm scale up here. Down here is your volt and current scale, and you got some more going down. So as you change the setting of the dial, it'll change where on the scale you're actually reading your measurement. Over here, it's a digital multimeter. Digital is going to read you out what you've got. So if I select AC volts, this is the most common type. This is a Fluke digital multimeter. So if I choose AC volts, my reading up here is going to be in AC volts. And it'll read from 1 to 1,000. Then you got DC volts, and then you got ohms up here, and then your current. You've got microamps and milliamps. You can even read a millivolt scale right there. So two different types of meters that you're going to see, and they each have their purpose. The most common used nowadays is the digital multimeter, but there are applications that require the analog movement, because the analog movement responds at the same speed of you touching up the wires. It's just as fast as you can get current through the coil that the needle's going to move. Whereas a digital multimeter, it's going to depend on the clock speed, how fast it does its samples. So for applications where you got to check when current comes on, you're going to want to use a analog versus a digital. Okay, and let's continue on with what we're doing. Okay, so analog meter uses a moving pointer and a printed scale to indicate your voltages, your values, voltage, current, resistance, whatever. A VOM, VOM allows all kinds of measurements on a single scale. And a digital, you're using a digital, an analog to digital chip inside of it, and you get a numerical readout. All right, when we are using the current meter function, so in this case it's a DC, direct current meter. Of course, the direct current in a moving coil meter deflects the pointer in proportion to the amount of current that you're putting through it. The current meter must be connected in series with the part of the circuit you're measuring. Whether it's a analog or digital, you always have to connect a current meter in series with your circuit, so it becomes part of the circuit. And of course, to get the right reading, you have to be connected with the correct polarity. So you're connecting it with the flow of current. So your negative side is going to go to your lowest potential, your positive side is going to go to your higher potential. And just for the heck of it, let's see here. I'm setting up my camera even as we speak here and finding this application. As soon as it finishes coming up and initializes my camera, here we go. So here we have a voltmeter and a current meter. And if I move my connection enough here, and let's get the voltmeter out of our way. And there we go. All right, so here's my circuit, and it's a basic series circuit. Matter of fact, it's a loaded voltage divider. And what we have here is we have the negative side coming to this resistor, then current's going to flow up. Here's my lower potential feeding into my meter, and then coming out of my meter is my higher potential going back to the voltage source. So I can, and there is no lead between the voltage source and the input up here of my resistor. So my current meter is filling that role of the piece of wire and allowing me to read current at the same time. So in this case, I'm set up on the milliamp scale, and I'm reading, and it's 2,000 microamp scale. So I'm reading 651 microamps feeding through this circuit. But once again, the meter is part of the circuit in that it takes the place of the wire that would go from this point to my voltage source. So the current is going through my negative wire, through my meter, my positive wire, back to my voltage source. So there you go with that. Now I can get that out of our way and then come back to our PowerPoint. Okay, so we're set up with the correct polarity, as I said. Now we'll go ahead and keep moving down, and here is our moving coil meter movement. And what it is the meter is surrounded by a magnet. All right, so the north side of the magnet's there, the south side of the magnet is here, and here's my coil. As we induce current into the coil through our plus and minus leads, we will develop a magnetic field, and that magnetic field will provide force against the north and south magnets and cause our pointer to move. So in this case, it'll move either that way. Well, it should just move that way, and in this case, it's set up at 4.5 volts, depending on the scale that's selected. So that's how the moving coil meter actually does its movement. Now, how do we keep from blowing that guy up? Because if you dump too much current in, that means that needle is going to max out pretty quickly, because we're only talking milliamps here. And I have to be able to measure several different scales. So in order to do that, and what we see here is two different scales. There's a 10 volt scale and there's a 25 volt scale. So you see the same amount of current is going to move that needle the same distance, but how we develop that current will depend on what scale we're on and what kind of shunt resistor we've put in to filter that current where we want it to go. All right, for a current meter, we use shunts. And what a shunt does, it allows me to put larger amounts of current through the meter than the coil can handle. And what it will do, it will bypass a portion of the current around the meter movement, and then of course my scale is graduated in proportion to the meter shunt that I've put in. And a meter shunt is nothing more than a parallel resistor. A resistor in parallel with the meter movement. And of course, it's going to be one of lower resistance than the meter itself. Because what did we say about the in a parallel circuit, the lower resistance gets the most current? Well, that's what's going to happen. So the shunt is a precision resistor that is going to bypass current around the meter movement itself. So in this case, excuse me, we have to figure out what size shunt we're going to need here. There we go. There's our shunt. And a lot of it depends on our maximum current that we're expecting to measure and our values at the meter itself. So in this case, I've got a meter movement that is 50 ohms. And I'm going to have 2 milliamps of current coming into that. Well, my meter movements also have a maximum current value. Okay, so I've got a meter movement that can go as high as 1 milliamp, and its resistance rating is at 50 ohms. So what size resistor would I need out here to ensure that I don't surpass 1 milliamp and I can still get current through? I'll get up to 1 milliamp through. Well, I've got 2 milliamps coming in. And so we just basically apply Ohm's law a couple different ways. So the voltage for the meter movement, so Vm, is going to equal the current maximum for the meter movement times the resistance for the meter movement. My current for the circuit is going to equal the current for the shunt minus the current through the total current, or the shunt current equals the total current minus the meter movement current, or the resistance for the shunt is going to equal the meter voltage over the shunt current. So in this case, I've got 1 milliamp max times 50 ohms. My meter voltage is going to be 50 millivolts. I know my shunt has got to handle 1 milliamp because I've got 2 milliamps going in. My maximum is 1 milliamp. So my final is the shunt current is going to be 1 milliamp. So the voltage, 50 millivolts, because it is a parallel circuit, so you're going to have the same voltage on both sides, maximum 50 millivolts, divided by how much current the shunt has to siphon off, 1 milliamp. So the shunt is going to be equal to 50 ohms. So that will bypass enough current to keep me from blowing up the meter. And I'm going to erase everything here real quick. There we go. A 50 ohm resistor is going to shunt off enough of the current, still allowing me current passing through my meter movement, but not surpassing my 1 milliamp maximum for the meter. And this can go on for larger values. Oops, wrong direction. Okay, this case, my maximum current is 5 milliamps. That's a maximum current for the scale I've selected for my meter. Remember, my meter has got a knob on it that I can select different values or different maximums. So in this case, I'm on the 5 milliamp scale. Well, my meter movement can still only handle 1 milliamp, which means my shunt resistor has got to be able to handle 4 milliamps. My meter movement voltage is still 50 millivolts, or 0.05 volts. Remember, that's the voltage for the meter equals the current for the meter times the resistance for the meter. So a 50 ohm meter, 1 milliamp maximum, 50 millivolts. So now I have 50 millivolts over 4 milliamps, which is going to equal, I bet you it's on the next page. Ah, rats. Oh, yes. 50 millivolts, 4 milliamps. So my resistor value has got to be 12.5 ohms. So that's what size shunt resistor needs to go into the meter. And that will allow me to handle a maximum of 5 milliamps for that circuit. So that's how a current meter works. All right, we select shunt resistors to extend the range, to allow it to handle larger and larger current values. And then, of course, the scale you're going to read on the meter face. Let's see here. Let's see if I can find a meter here real quick. He said dropping his meter. Amazingly enough, he didn't. Well, he may have broken it. Oh, dear. Well, dropping it sure as heck didn't help. But that's neither here nor there. The idea here is to get the video up. Dum de dum de dum dum dum. And it helps if you select the right pointer option here. Okay, here we have a meter, and if I can get it focused well enough. There we go. Now, depending on the setting I select for the range, I can go up to 10, 50, 125, or 250. So that is selecting a scaly or a bypass resistor or a shunt resistor that's going to allow a maximum of, say, 10 amps, 50 amps, 125 amps, or 250 amps. Or it could be milliamps. Let's see here. Actually, my scale in this case is 50 micro, so it's all going to be read on the 50 scale here. And then it's going to go in multiples of 10. So 50 micro, 5 milli, 50 milli, or 500 milliamps. So that's how the scale is read, to a maximum of 500 milliamps. And that just depends on what resistor I choose, or what range setting I select down here on the DC amp scale. Oh, I can go all the way up to 10 amps. My thumb was covering it before. So there you go. This is your basic analog meter. And we'll get rid of that now. and get back on with the program. All right, now voltmeters. Voltmeters are handled a little bit differently. Once again, we have scales that range from 10 to, let's see, DC voltage, I've got 250 milli, 2.5 volts, 10 volts, 50 volts, and up to 1,000 volt scale. Now, what you're going to do is you're connecting in parallel with your circuit. And if I bring the camera back up here, I keep shutting it all the way down. Maybe I shouldn't do that. Let's see here. Okay, bringing my digital meters back up. And we'll adjust the focus a little bit here. There we go. All right, we still have the current meter connected in series with the circuit. Now I'm going to take my voltmeter and I'm connecting my voltmeter in parallel across the circuit. Okay, and I'm having a little bit of connection issue here. There we go. All right. So now I'm going through a 5-volt voltage regulator here, so it's going to hold it somewhere in the 5-volt range, but I've connected the meter across... Oops. Always got to get the right pointer going here. Okay, my meter... voltmeter is connected at that point and that point in parallel with my voltage divider. Of course, I've got to observe polarity, so there's my positive end closest to my plus side of my voltage source. Here's my negative end at the lowest end potential that's hooked into my ground bus here. And so I'm measuring the voltage source at 4.94 volts. Now, I've got more scales, as you can see on here. I can go, and you can't see the scale completely. Or I've crashed that thing out. Looks like I crashed out my camera a little bit. There we go. So now you can see the scale a little bit better. And the scale starts at 200 millivolts down here, 200 millivolts, 2,000 millivolts, or 2 volts, 20 volts, 200 volts, and 1,000 volts. So how do we extend that range? How do we make sure that my meter movement or the analog to digital converter in here doesn't get burned up by putting in too much voltage? Well, we do that through the use of scaling resistors that are in series with our circuit, with our meter movement. So we want to make sure that the scaler or multiplier will not allow enough current with however many volts we put in. We have to make sure it does not allow so much current that we're going to blow up our meter movement. So that's a multiplier resistor in series with the meter movement. And of course, as I said, we're connecting a voltmeter in parallel across two points, and we have to observe polarity. So a multiplier resistor is a large enough resistor which will allow the meter to measure voltage in the circuit, so we're going to once again control the current going through the meter through the use of resistors. And since it's a series circuit, we are just going to make that resistance large enough to control the current in the whole circuit. So we're not trying to bypass any current. We are putting a resistor in line to decrease the current. Uh-oh, and we got a runtime error. Well, that takes care of that runtime error. All right, so in this case, we are measuring across a 10-volt source. Once again, my meter movement can only handle, well, let's see what they've got here. Let's see, I've got my resistance in the meter over voltage, 1,000 ohms per volt. We're not going to worry about that right now. Okay, we're not worried about the sensitivity. Let's see here. Meter current, there we go. There's our voltage source minus the resistor for the meter. Basically, we have to control the multiplier size so we do not spike out the meter range or the current going through the meter range. And what I'm looking for here is, okay, current meter times, oh, okay. They're just giving me my voltage for the meter. So basically, I've got a 0.1 volt meter. I've got 100 millivolts maximum can go through the meter. I got a 10 volt source. So this resistor has got to have a 9.9 volt voltage drop. So my current for the meter, once again, is going to be, they're not telling me what my current for the meter has got to be, but at 1 volt and, say, 100 milliohms, let's go find another one here. Don't care about the sensitivity of the meter right now, and it's not moving down for me. Like that. How about like that? Nope. All right. Okay, it appears I've got this squared away now. All right, so here's a typical meter. And the meter scale. So 2.5 volts, 10 volts, 50 volts, 250 volts, 1,000 volts, and then throw in another scaler multiplier for a 5,000 volt scale. Now the whole object is to keep this guy from exceeding 50 microamps. So the voltage drop across this guy, his resistance value is 2k ohms. His current is 50 microamps. So voltage expected. Wherever I put my calculator, there it is. Is 2,000 times 0.00005 equals 100 millivolts. So this guy is going to drop no more than 100 millivolts. So it just depends on which lead we've got selected. If we select the 2.5 volt position, this resistor is going to have to drop 2.4 volts at, okay, we always use this maximum here as our maximum current, so the entire circuit has got to deal with 50 microamps. So 2.4 volts divided by 50 microamps, it's probably going to equal 48k ohms. So we'll bring up the calculator again, and look at my numbers. 0.00005 1 over x times 2.4 is going to equal 48k ohms, which is exactly what we're saying over here. If I go to the 10 volt scale, this guy is still going to want to drop 100 millivolts or 0.1 volt. So now the combination of our series multipliers have got to drop 9.9 volts. Our current never changes. We have to control the current at a maximum of 50 microamps. So this scaling pair here now is going to have to equal this value minus that value. And if we do the math once again, .00005 1 over x times 9.9 volts, pardon me, equals 198,000 ohms minus 48,000 ohms equals 150,000 ohms, so 150k ohms. So there we have that guy. Between the two, 198 k ohms, and so on. Each one of these resistor networks is going to have to equal the value given minus the voltage of the meter over the meter current. And that will give you your total network value. So that's how a voltmeter actually works. Now, whether this is a coil movement meter, okay, that will move, or if it's a digital multimeter, the scaling networks work about the same no matter what kind of meter it is. It just depends on the actual meter values, the current value, or pardon me, the resistance value for the meter and the maximum current for that meter. Okay, and we've already discussed the multiplier resistance. Okay, analog voltmeters, this is just some general, it's not necessarily 100%. Okay, voltmeters are rated in terms of ohms. Oh yes, this is the sensitivity. The sensitivity is rated in terms of ohms of resistance required for 1 volt of deflection on the meter movement itself. So that is your ohms ohms per volt rating or the sensitivity of the voltmeter. And so the ohms per volt rating is the same for all ranges. It is determined by the full scale current of the meter movement. So the meter resistance can be calculated by multiplying the ohms per volt rating and the full scale voltage. Once again, that's general technical specs for the meters themselves, the meter movements. All right, now what's important is the meter resistance. Why is that important? Well, we are putting a meter in parallel with our circuit. So what happens if the resistance is too low in the meter? What happens to the current flow in the circuit? Well, the current flow is going to want to go through the meter instead of the circuit, and we're going to end up with an erroneous value. And that is called loading down the circuit. Once again, you have a parallel circuit. And you stick a meter across that. Well, if this meter is too low, once again, too low a current or too low a value, then this entire circuit is going to change value. So meters are usually in the mega ohm ranges. Meaning, yeah, they're there, the circuit kind of sees them, but it's not enough to affect the normal operation of the circuit. So you get a reasonable value. But if the meter's too low, all of a sudden you've changed the characteristic of the circuit and you're not providing yourself a true reading on your meter movement. So that's loading down the circuit or meter load. Okay, so here's the same thing. You've got your circuit design, two 100 k ohm resistors. They're in series with each other, so it's 200 k ohms. You got 60 volts of voltage drop across each resistor. You stick on a meter that's not a great enough value. And as a matter of fact, in this case, it's too close to the circuit value. So instead of having a 100 k ohm resistor in the circuit, you've suddenly turned the equivalent into 50 k ohms. So across these two points, points 1 and 2, you're suddenly only measuring 40 volts. And all of a sudden, R1 is dropping 80 volts. So that's why you have to make sure that your meter has got a high enough resistance to it. Okay, in this case, you have a 10 mega ohm meter. You're barely going to see any change at all. If you do the math, you're going to be closer to 100 k ohms than any other time. So you're still just going to see the 60 volt drop, and your meter is going to read properly. So the higher the resistance of the meter, the better your circuit's going to like it. Let's see here. Digital multimeters, usually around 10 to 20 megs in all ranges. How come I suddenly am not writing like I should be? There we go. And this pretty much says everything that I just talked about. So we're going to keep on going. Okay, ohm meters. Now, in the very beginning of the course, we talked a little bit about ohm meters, and we gave some precautions to take. One of those was make sure the circuit is non-powered, and you isolate whatever you're measuring from the rest of the circuit. Well, that's because an ohm meter has got an internal battery, and it's in series with the meter movement. Basically, you're setting up a series circuit when you're measuring with an ohm meter. And then depending on the size of the resistor, you're going to be getting either more or less current to the meter movement itself. So you're producing a current flow, and that current, the measurement is going to be a movement in proportion to that current flow. And we use what's called a backoff scale on analog meters. With most meters, we start at zero and work our way up. Yeah, let's go ahead and bring that back up one more time. I might be a little disorganized today. It is my 35th wedding anniversary. I'm trying to plan too many things at once here. All right, we're going to bring that guy in there and find that meter again. Where did I set it? I set it right there. All right. Now, where most of the scales start off at zero, okay, with no current in, and then work their way up in value, the ohm meter with no current in starts at infinite resistance. Once again, an open, no current flow tells you you've got infinite resistance. Then depending on the value of the resistor, you're going to get either more or less current flow. Well, you're going to get more than zero. You will be moving your needle over. So the more current means less resistance. So you see 100 ohms there, 1 ohm there. So once again, more current, less resistance. So this is a backoff scale. So we use the current from the internal battery to give us the deflection. Our deflection is proportional to the current flow. Once again, more current, less resistance, because we're talking Ohm's law here. And we're displaying on a backoff scale, meaning we start with no current at the highest range and with more current going to the lowest range. So just reverse of most meter readings. Okay, so here is our circuit for an ohm meter. Okay, once again, 1 milliamp max at 50 ohms. So we've got a 50 ohm resistor in line here. Our maximum is 1 milliamp. So now we are using, once again, a scaling resistor in series. And of course, the current is going to flow back through our internal battery. So this is with our two leads shorted. We've just got our meter and our resistor. Now what we're going to do is we're going to calibrate our scale in this condition. So this will read 0 ohms. So all the current is accounted for. Now any other resistance out here is going to cause that needle, it's going to decrease our current because we're going to increase our resistance, and we're going to cause our needle to go back toward infinity. So in this condition, we calibrate out that resistor by shorting our leads together and making our little calibration dial. It's going to go to zero. Now we're ready to stick a resistance out here, and basically that resistor is going to end up in series with the meter and our scaling resistor and decrease our current accordingly. So if I was to stick a 1500 ohm resistor, since my scaler is 1450 and my meter resistance is 50 ohm, together they're going to be 1500 ohms. If I was to stick a 1500 ohm resistor out here, my needle movement would go dead center because it's going to be half the current of the original. I've doubled the resistance, I've halved the current. And that's basically what they're going to show you here. In this case, they're showing you putting in a variable resistor and out to 150 k ohms. So as you vary this resistor from zero, where it'll read zero there, and you increase the resistance and decrease the current, your needle will go there. Since this is 1500 ohms internal resistance, when I get to 1500 ohms, my needle movement will be dead center, because it'll be half the current, and on the right scale, it's at 1500 ohms. So, ohm meters. You create a series circuit and use the principle of the inverse proportionality of current to resistance to move your meter. Okay, multimeters are also called multitesters. And once again, they're used to measure voltage, current, or resistance. Some of them will also do components, tell you whether a transistor is good, tell you whether a diode is good. Different kind, you got your volt ohm meter, which is your analog meter, and your DMM, which we've discussed, your digital multimeter. And your table 8.3 gives you your difference between the two. And we're not going to go into that. I'm going to let you read that on your own. Okay, once again, here's two different examples. Here's a good old Simpson 280, it looks like, which is a common analog volt or analog multimeter. Used everywhere, still used in the military, still used in the section I work in. They're still used everywhere because they're very dependable and you can get that instant movement of the needle. And then this one's a Tektronix. I prefer Fluke multimeters, digital. Don't ask me why, I just am used to using Flukes. Okay, let's see here. High current conditions are showing this guy. This is a high current condition. And instead of trying to put this meter in the circuit, he's using the principle of magnetic lines of flux. He's checking the magnetic field, and the meter will give him a reading of current for the strength of that magnetic field. And you notice he's using nice big heavy gloves when he's doing it because it's a very high voltage application. Anytime you put current through a wire, it is going to generate a magnetic field. That's something you got to realize. That is also called electromagnetic interference. It's generating EMI. But in this case, we actually use that principle to make our measurement. Okay, and we've already pretty well talked about that section. There's a nice Fluke multimeter right there. One of the problems with analog meters is for the different scales that we have. Now let me get my pointer back on here. For the different scales that we have, got a different line. So if I'm reading the 10 volt scale, I got to be sure that I'm reading on this line. If I'm reading the 125 volt scale, I got to make sure I'm reading on this line. You can get those confused from time to time. You can misread. You can think you're reading on this line and you're actually reading on this line. Digital multimeters don't have that problem. Digital multimeters give you one reading. Doesn't matter what scale you're on. For instance, if you select the DC voltage range, it's going to be able to self-adjust through the voltage range. My little red ones, being cheap, they're more like the needle deflection. They're more like the analog. They just happen to have a digital display. Whereas the high-end ones, they self-adjust. You don't have to worry about the scale you're on or think about. So they are easier to use, and they eliminate human error from reading the different scales. Okay, and once again, different things you can do with the different. Okay, voltmeter, ammeter, ohmmeter. So you put it power on in the circuit. You're working power on in the circuit. You want to make sure your power off is in the circuit. Voltmeter, you're connecting in parallel. Current meter, you're connecting in series. Ohmmeter, you're connecting in parallel, but you want to isolate the device that you're measuring. Voltmeter, high internal resistance. Current meter, low internal resistance. Ohmmeter, you got an internal battery you got to deal with. Voltmeter, internal series multipliers, so higher resistance for higher ranges, because you're just making a voltage divider, making sure that you don't exceed the maximum voltage or current for the meter movement itself. Current meter, you have internal shunt, so a parallel path for current to go. Lower resistances for higher current settings, because you have to bypass the excess current around the meter, so you use a lower resistance. And ohmmeter, once again, higher battery voltage, you got more sensitive, so you can get a meter with higher ohms ranges. Once again, you're creating a series circuit using a voltage divider, so you're creating a voltage divider using the resistor that you're hanging out there, and the amount of current change is going to give you your resistance reading. Okay, here they're showing you reading different spots to get your current readings. Okay. Using your milliamp meter here, you're going to read the current for the entire circuit. This is your main trunk line. Putting the current meter there, you're also going to read your main trunk current, because that path and this path have come together, forming a single path. All right? Because it's current, and this resistor is in series, readings A is going to equal reading B, which is going to equal reading C. For E and D, you're going to get this current path, I2 only. All right, they're in this current path. G and F, you're going to see current 3. Okay, they're in this current path. So, depends on where you put your meter, what current you're going to read in the path. Voltmeter, you can go across, you're going in parallel, so you can go across R2 here, you can go across R1 here. You're going to read the voltage drop across this resistor. Because you're creating a high R, high resistance, high resistance parallel path. using your voltage meter. So it won't change the circuit, but you will be able to get enough current to read your voltage. Okay, once again, voltmeter, because we have a common ground, okay, this means all these are tied together. If you are, and here's your voltage source. Okay, voltage source, you got an open at R3. Are you going to read anything across it in that meter? Well, no, you're not going to read anything at that meter, because there's no current flow. Okay, no path back to the positive side there. If you come over here to point C, though, and still connect to ground, then you are going to have a current path. And you're going to be reading basically across those two resistors. Okay? So remember, current path going that way. So even though you got an open there, if you hook up to point C and to ground, because you've got a common ground in all these spots, you're going to have a current path to read the voltage. Dun-dun-dun-dun. What now? Going down. Okay, continuity. We've talked about continuity. You guys can read more about this in your own books. Okay, you know how to check continuity with an ohmmeter. And that's about it. So, this week we got to see how a current meter actually works. We got to see how a voltmeter actually works and the workings behind an ohm meter. You got to see a couple examples of meters stuck in the circuit. Next time, and that will be for lesson 4. So in the next lesson, we're going to see how to analyze a circuit without having to use a meter and stuff. And how a meter can come into play in circuit analysis. You don't have to have the meter, but when you're doing a circuit analysis with some unknowns, you got to have it. And that's about all I've got this time. If you have questions, once again, don't forget to ask them. Don't forget to look at problems in the book and work through your problems in your book, especially when dealing with Chapter 7. Depending on the questions I receive will determine whether or not I'm lecturing next week. If I don't, I'll let you know. If I do, there'll be a lecture up. Once again, Wednesdays, I at least open up my office and I sit in there for a while, and if nobody shows up, then I leave. But if you show up, I will stay as long as you need me to stay. So keep that in mind also. Other than that, I will talk to you next time I talk to you. Bye.